is concerning Christ's mediation in the heavenly sanctuary, story of redemption 381, and also the beast revelation, is God trying the statement here in track number 12 that God is in at supreme pains. Here in track number 12, page 28, it says, a full realization of the glorious reward that awaits mankind will even now compel men to shout for joy, and a like realization of the dreadful penalty that awaits all who fail to make God their refuge will cause them even now to weep and gnash their teeth. That all might realistically see these alternative prospects and be impelled thereby to repentance, the Lord has been at supreme pains not only to record a graphic description of the evil which through the instrumentality of the beast Satan has determined upon the whole world, but also aforehand to make of a similar evil a perfect type of the image of the beast. So here the voice of inspiration is plainly telling that the Lord is at supreme pains to record in a graphic description of the evil which through the instrumentality of the beast, or meaning through the instrumentality of that system, the complete satanic system to deceive God's people. And what is the focal point of such deception? To hide, to cancel to their minds, to their understanding concerning Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary. And that is the reason that the last three beasts, the nondescript, the leopard-like, and the scarlet-colored beast, brothers and sisters, is that the principal reason why God revealed that three last beasts representing the entire New Testament era, according to 2 SR 85 and 86, brothers and sisters, is to reveal the true condition of the churches. What is the true condition of the churches? Brothers and sisters, the true condition is that Satan had been able to successfully hide them from their minds, from their thoughts, the proceedings in the heavenly sanctuary, threw them underfoot. It seems that it became out of value, and nobody focused their attention in studying the sanctuary doctrine, by which in reality, Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary is about to be finished. And the people has no knowledge at all. So that is the focal point, brothers and sisters, in this study concerning the beast revelation, by which we need to understand. Now, if we will be studying the beast revelation, by which in reality, the outcome of our study is that the sanctuary doctrine or the Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary is still unknown in our understanding, then for sure, brothers and sisters, the intention of God in revealing this beast revelation to completely uncover the traps of the devil had not been met. And Satan is only laughing in the dark, brothers and sisters, because we are in total darkness concerning the occurrence in the heavenly sanctuary, more pertaining to the judgment for the living. Now, let us now focus our attention, brothers and sisters, to repeat again. What is the teaching of the shepherd's rod concerning the particular object in view concerning the leopard like beast. Now, let us read track number 12. Here in track number 12, on page 21 and page 22. So, let us read this reading. Track number 12, page 21 and page 22. It says, the beast 40 and 2 month period falls in the time of ecclesiastical Rome, the empire after pagan Rome. So that was in 538 AD to 1798 AD. Whereas its wounded state symbolized here during the Protestant period. When does the wounded state of the leopard like this? During the Protestant period. Brothers and sisters, we should observe the grammar used by inspiration saying, whereas. The word whereas always connotes, indicates opposite to the previous statement. So the shepherd's rod is plainly telling that during the Dark Ages, 538 to 1798 AD, brothers and sisters, it says that in that period of time, that is not the period of time by which the leopard-like beast had been wounded, because it says, whereas, meaning, pointing to another period of time, the wounded state of the leopard-like beast is during the Protestant period. Now, when does the Protestant period begins? In 2 TG 22, pages 21 and page 22. This symbolical prophecy is seen to corroborate history. It points out that the Christian church at first suffered martyrdom shown by the color red, then followed the dark ages of religion when the church was in captivity black. Following this came the Protestant period, the period of religious freedom, white theme. 2 TG 22, 21 and 22. The shepherds had made it so plain that the Protestant period begins after the Dark Ages. Now let us read answerer number 3, page 45. Answerer number 3, page 44 and page 45. Let us read. It says, is the beast both secular and ecclesiastical power? Does not the head that was wounded to death, Revelation 13 verse 3, represent the combined secular and ecclesiastical power of the Middle Ages? Answer, those who understand that the wounded head of the leopard-like beast, Revelation 13 verse 1 to 3, symbolizes Rome in her ecclesiastical period, doubtless also understand that the little horn which had the eyes of men and a mouth speaking great things, Daniel 7 verse 8, likewise symbolizes Rome before the head was wounded. Rightly to understand the subject, it is necessary to examine this double face symbol from the ground up, beginning with Daniel's view. Having eyes of men and a mouth and a little horn is actually a horn head, a unique thing among governments, a composite hierarchy of civil and religious powers fused into one sovereign head. During the Dark or Middle Ages, the glory that was Rome's. Accordingly, the medieval union of secular and ecclesiastical powers in the Roman Church gives the key to the interpretation of both the horn and the head, proving that the head, which was wounded unto death, is figurative of the ecclesiastical part only. For on the leopard-like beast, Rome is not represented by either a wounded horn or a horn head, but by a wounded head only, which shows that the blow affected not the secular half, the state horn, but only the ecclesiastical half, the church head. Answerer number 3, page 44 and page 45. Now, do we believe the statement that the deadly blow that thrown by Martin Luther affected only half of the ecclesiastical? Brothers and sisters, it is only half of the ecclesiastical. Remember, we are dealing only spiritual aspects. And when it comes to ecclesiastical, it points out to the doctrines that had been wounded by Martin Luther. Why is it that the shepherd's rod says, brothers and sisters, according to that reading, that only half of the ecclesiastical that had been wounded by Martin Luther, not the entire ecclesiastical? Remember, the one that ruled during the Dark Ages is Catholicism. 2SR, page 123. And it is called by the Shepherd's Rod in 2SR 114, monosectarian system. And that ecclesiastical head is founded by two main doctrines. What is the two main doctrines that had been established with that ecclesiastical head? The immortality of the soul and the Sunday observance. The mere fact that the shepherd's rod made it so plain that only half of the ecclesiastical, meaning only half of the doctrine, which is the fundamental doctrines of the Catholics that had been wounded by Martin Luther, which is the immortality of the soul, it's so because the other half, it cannot be affected by the blow of Martin Luther, because Martin Luther himself is a Sunday keeper. He has no knowledge concerning the other half of the foundation of the doctrines of the Catholics, which is the Paul's doctrine. Brothers and sisters, pertaining to Sunday observance. Now, I would like to read the Great Controversy, page 448 and 449. Let me read to you. Although there are many passages that we would like to prove this statement, brothers and sisters. And let us read. It says here, the theory of immortality of the soul, the Great Controversy, 548 and 549. The theory of the immortality of the soul was one of those false doctrines that Rome, borrowing from paganism, incorporated into the religion of Christendom. Martin Luther classed it with the monstrous fables that form part of the Roman dunghill of decretals. It says, commenting on the words of Solomon in Ecclesiastes, that the dead know not anything, the reformer says, another place proving that the dead have no feeling, there is said he no duty, no science, no knowledge, no wisdom there. Solomon judged that the dead are asleep and feel nothing at all, for the dead lie there, accounting neither days nor years, but when they are awake, they shall seem to have slept scarce 1 minute. Martin Luther, the Great Controversy, 548 and 549. So, brothers and sisters, only that doctrine, only half of the foundation of the doctrines of the Roman Catholics that have been wounded by Martin Luther, because the other doctrines, which is pointing to, brothers and sisters, Sunday observance, Martin Luther had not been able to deliver a deadly blow with that doctrine, brothers and sisters, because he himself is a Sunday keeper, brothers and sisters. And I would like to read this reading, brothers and sisters, that here in the Great Controversy, in page 449, but when Sunday observance shall be enforced by law, and the world shall be enlightened concerning the obligation of the true Sabbath, then whoever shall transgress the command of God to obey a precept which has no higher authority than that of Rome, will thereby honor papery above God. He is paying homage to Rome and to the power which enforced the institution ordained by Rome. So, Sunday observance, it is an institution ordained by the Roman Catholicism, brothers and sisters. So, the shepherd's rod can never be mistaken. The deadly blow that had been delivered by Martin Luther only affect half of the ecclesiastical. So, the half of the ecclesiastical that was wounded by Martin Luther is the groundwork and the unfulfilled portion of the leopard like beast. The other half of Catholicism, which is Sunday observance, it is the particular object in view. And the one who wounded it, brothers and sisters, for sure. Let us read tract number 8. Here on page 59. It says, the 5 smooth stones in David's bag, with one of which he slew Goliath, typify the 5 fold power in the antitypical shepherd's bag, the Bible. With one part of which God shall today smite the beast and his image, the nations, the antitypical Goliath. And since we know that it is by his word, in the form of a message, that he shall smite the nations, then obviously, the 5 smooth stones represent 5 messages, the last of which is to warn the beast, destroy his image, and free God's people from the fear of the heathen. Now look at the statement. The last stone represented by the 11th hour message is the message that will wound the leopard like beast. Now that statement perfectly corroborating to tract number 12, page 21 and 22. That the period of the leopard-like beast wounded state is in the Protestant period. When does the Protestant period begin? 2 TG 22:22, after the Dark Ages. As a matter of fact, to repeat again, tract number 12, page 21 and 22 itself, very plain, because the word whereas indicates opposite meaning to the previous statement. The previous statement saying, during the Dark Ages, brothers and sisters, the 42 months of the leopard-like beast by which he blasphemed God and his tabernacle. But it says, whereas its wounded state is in the Protestant period. The Protestant period is after 1798, 2 TG 22:22. Tract number 8, page 59, the one that will wound the beast is the message that cometh from God. And the only part of the wounded head that delivered by Martin Luther, only half of the ecclesiastical. Answerer number 3, page 45. Why is it only half? Because that head on the leopard-like beast is Catholicism, according to 1 SR 220. That is the Catholic Church. And the Catholic Church is founded into 2 main fundamental doctrines: immortality of the soul and the Sunday observance. And we already read in the Great Controversy 548 and 549 that the only part by which Martin Luther had been able to wound the little horn head, brothers and sisters, is concerning the immortality of the soul. And it utters the impossibility that Martin Luther had been able to wound the half of the foundation of the little horn head, which is the Sunday observance, because he himself is a Sunday keeper. But we know that the statement in tract number 8, page 59, that the one to wound the beast, it is the message of the 11th hour. And then in 2SR 230 and 231, it says, what is the message? The 11th hour message is none other than Revelation 18, brothers and sisters. It says here in 2SR 230 and 231, what is the message? The 11th hour message is none other than Revelation 18. And we know, all of us, the Bedian, understood that in 1888, the glimmering of the message of Revelation 18, although it is muffled because of their attitude of rejecting the message. But the fact is, the shepherd's rod is very clear that the leopard-like beast had been wounded in the Protestant period, 1798 onwards. What message to wound? It is the 11th hour message. What is the 11th hour message? Revelation 18. And it came in 1888, and this is the other half by which it was not wounded by Martin Luther, the Sunday observance. When it was introduced in 1888, the Sunday bill, brothers and sisters. Now, let us read again here in the National Sunday Law. It says, this pamphlet is a report of an argument made upon the National Sunday Bill, introduced by Senator Blair in the 50th Congress. It is not, however, exactly the argument that was made before the Senate committee, as there were so many interruptions in the course of my speech that it was impossible to make a connected argument upon a single point. By these questions, etc., my argument was not only forced to take a wider range than was intended when I began to speak, but I was prevented from making the definite argument that I designed to present. I do not speak of these interruptions and counter arguments by way of complaint, but only to explain why this pamphlet is issued. Nevertheless, it is a fact that while there were 18 speeches before mine, occupying 3 hours, in all of which together there were only 189 questions and counter arguments by all the members of the committee who were present, I was interrupted by the chairman alone 169 times in 90 minutes, as may be seen by the official report of the hearing, 50th Congress, Second Session, Messages and Documents, number 43, pages 73 to 102. A national Sunday law is a question of national interest. While it is true that the Sunday rest bill did not become a law, the legislation having died with the expiration of the 50th Congress. Then this historical event, brothers and sisters, without any doubt, that is the time by which the other half of the wounded head of the leopard-like beast had been wounded in 1888, the Sunday, concerning the Sunday rest bill that had been introduced in 1888. And we already explained, brothers and sisters, that according to the Bible, very plain in Revelation 13, verse 15, and he had power to give life unto the image of the beast. Now, the image of the beast is pointing to the bill that had been introduced. The mere fact that it says had power to give life indicates that it died. Because you will not give life to anything except it died, brothers and sisters. And it, that bill died in 1888. But the fact is, it was predicted beforehand that that predicted president of the United States of America, he will be the one to give life to that bill that died in 1888. But God revealed it through the beast revelation, how it will come. And how could we be able to prepare for it, brothers and sisters? And that is what the book of Revelation, the intention of God to escape the oncoming destruction, because the Sunday movement is making its way in the darkness. According to volume 5, page 452, brothers and sisters, think it thoroughly. You cannot see it, apparently. Or in other words, brothers and sisters, I would like to say this thing. If the deception of Satan concerning the beast, the image, and the mark can be easily discerned by finite observation, then there is no need for God to waste his time to reveal to John concerning this vision, this revelation. The mere fact that the Shepherd's Rod says in tract number 12, page 27, page 28 rather, that God is at supreme pains in revealing this truth. How the old enemy determined to deceive the whole world shows that such deception, brothers and sisters, is, I remember the statement here in 2SR, page, let me read to you. B.T. Hodem says that 2SR page 2SR page that such deception, brothers and sisters, is page 95. It says, a spiritual deception has its beginning. Let's read this statement. 2SR page 95. A spiritual deception has its beginning from a being other than human. Therefore, the scheme is so cunning that it cannot be discerned by finite observation. This kind of deception can only be recognized under the close scrutiny of the Holy Word of God and by the aid of His Spirit. I would like to read again the statement. It says, a spiritual deception has its beginning from a being other than human. Therefore, the scheme is so cunning that it cannot be discerned by finite observation. This kind of deception can only be recognized under the close scrutiny of the Holy Word of God and by the aid of His Spirit. 2SR page 95. So, brothers and sisters, my admonition is that we need to study closely the beast revelation, and we should not twist the meaning of its symbolization. Although in reality you will have a hard time to twist, but what you can only do is you can evade, you can avoid. And then take it for granted, brothers and sisters. But it will never benefit any one of us unless we study the beast revelation in sincerity and in honesty and try to see it. What is God's intention of such revelation, of the beast revelation? But we already explained the intention of God is to reveal the true condition of the churches and to tell the fall of the church. Or, in other words, the intention of God is that to let the people know that those churches by which supposed to be God's ideal, they will be the one to be the channel of revelation to inform the people concerning Christ's mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary. But contrariwise, they became the instruments of the devil so that such mediation of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary became obscured and cancelled from the understanding of God's people. That is God's intention, brothers and sisters. So, hoping that you will continue listening this message, and because I tried my best that I could be able to explain the most important part of this revelation concerning the nondescript beast, the leopard-like beast, as well as the scarlet colored beast. So thank you very much, brethren, for listening and viewing this program. Hoping the good Lord will bless you and have a wonderful evening.